From our studios in New York, here is Stone Phillips.
Good evening. It's a land filled with breathtaking beauty, but it's among the most dangerous places on Earth to be a child. It's Uganda, an East African country you may know because of this man, dictator Idi Amin. His bloody reign ended 26 years ago. But now someone else has inherited his legacy of terror. He's a rebel leader whose army comes in the night to kidnap children. They have stolen tens of thousands. The government of Uganda wants to stop him, but here's the problem. Many of the rebel soldiers the government would fight are the very children he stole. As you might expect, the images from this war of children are disturbing. Here's Keith Morrison.
It starts as a trickle. As darkness sets in, it becomes an unending stream. A phenomenon perhaps like no other anywhere on Earth. Children alone. It happens every night. It's happening at this moment. Tens of thousands of children. They're coming here for one simple reason. They want to survive the night. They know what's out there. Little boys like Patrick know what's waiting for them in the dark.
Sometimes they use an axe, anything, kill you, and sometimes they use guns.
But is this just a child's vivid imagination? Look at this. Around northern Uganda, this is what happens to little children who don't find a safe place at night. To adults, too. Burned to death for beyond recognition. Body parts cut off. Noses, lips, ears, fingers. Not a few, not a trickle. An awful, bloody flood.
This is terror like no other terror.
Jan Egeland is the UN's head of disaster relief. He's seen it all, but nothing like this.
I've been in 100 countries. I've been working with human rights, with peace, with humanitarian problems for 25 years. I was shocked to my bones seeing what happened there. I've never seen anything as bad. For me, this is one of the biggest scandals of our time and generation.
The root of this trauma is a civil war that has raged for 19 years here in northern Uganda, almost unnoticed by the rest of the world. Thousands upon thousands have died. And what makes this stand out from other wars is that it's being fought with children, like these escaped soldiers. Thousands of them, children stolen from their families, forced to become soldiers at the age of 8 or 10 or 12, forced to kill. Who steals the souls of children?
God said in the Bible that I will unleash my wrath upon you and you will suffer pain.
His name is Joseph Kony. He imagines he's a reincarnation of Jesus. He calls his group the Lord's Resistance Army. With virtually no popular support, he has increasingly resorted to abducting children to fight for him, against not only government forces, but his own people, civilians. His army has stolen as many as 30,000 innocent kids since the war began. He is anything but a defender of the people. Them he terrorizes.
Your nose will be cut off together with your ears, and in the end, the sword will kill you. Your children will be taken into captivity, and they'll be burned to death.
His maniacal rants are more than empty threats. Listen to what these kids say they were forced to do.
There was a boy who could not walk anymore because he was too thirsty, so they made us kill him with a club.
Attempting to escape is dangerous.
If you are captured trying to escape, you will be beaten or killed.
Girls are no exception. They are forced to fight or something else. Become sex slaves for the rebels.
They gathered all the girls aged 13 years and above. They then distributed us to the commanders as their wives.
These are the lucky ones, escapees, now in recovery centers like this. But you can see the damage in their eyes. It's in the pictures they draw that the horror at the hands of Kony comes back to life.
He knows how to instill utter fear, but he also knows how to make them believe that he has some kind of a mission.
Almost a supernatural power.
Yes.
Where does Kony fit in the sort of pantheon of evil people?
I think Kony is among the worst.
Among the worst because Kony preys on children. Easier to indoctrinate, control, have them commit atrocities. Fear of Kony and his rebels is so strong that more than 1.5 million people have been forced from their homes for fear of being killed or abducted. They go to squalid camps, barely surviving on foreign food donations, hoping that government army patrols might provide a little more protection than they had in their villages. This is Pabo Camp. On the scale of sheer misery, there is little that can top Pabo. 63,000 souls jammed into a vast sea of tiny round mud huts, 10 to a room or more. One water well for every 5,000 people. There's malnutrition, malaria, cholera, HIV. People here have grown accustomed to tragedy upon tragedy.
In the past year alone, Pabo has been burned out, flooded out, attacked constantly. But if life in the camp is dreadful, outside it is a catalog of horrors. Children are taught early that to stray to the edges of Pabo for fun, for firewood, or water, or food, is to risk being abducted, or raped, or hacked to death by the rebels.
But more often than not, the children in northern Uganda have their own survival routines. They are these thousands of desperate children, the ones called the night commuters. Remember young Patrick? He is one of them. He lives in a tiny unprotected village in a mud hut with his aunt and uncle and his dog, Sarah. And because he knows the danger of being killed or abducted into the rebel army all too well, he has a survival ritual. Each morning he washes, puts on his school clothes, and walks to class. Each evening, as dusk arrives, he joins what may be the world's most astonishing migration. Barefoot, a blanket stuffed in a sack, he walks for 5 miles through remote and sometimes dangerous terrain to the relative safety of town, where the rebels are less likely to attack. Mothers with infants, small children, boys, girls, leaving their parents behind in those isolated villages. They carry straw sleeping mats, their worldly possessions. Here, at least, they feel safe from the rebels. Most of the children know no other way of life, let alone why this war is being fought. Patrick sleeps in a crowded school, a nighttime shelter run by volunteers. Others find spots on the grass, under verandas, on hospital grounds, in large tents. Worn blankets, their only protection. Their bodies crammed together, tangled, entwined. Night after night after night, thousands and thousands, dreaming the restless dreams of the forsaken. In the morning, before the sun rises, they gather their belongings and leave for home, surviving another night. But it's not just a matter of survival. For Patrick, the shelter gives daily comfort to a soul tormented by what he witnessed, and even more so by something the rebels forced him to do. Patrick is an escapee. He's what a rebel soldier looks like.
Did you see other people being killed?
Many. Many, many.
Patrick, now a tiny 13-year-old, was 10 when the war came his way. Within minutes, he had committed murder.
We normally use a big sticks to kill somebody if you need.
You said you usually used a big sticks?
Yeah.
Did you kill more than one?
Yeah.
Many?
Many. For fear, you must kill. If you refuse, you are going to be killed.
And then out came the story that none of us who heard it have been able to forget. How Patrick learned the lesson, kill or be killed. It was, he said, the very first night of his abduction. Patrick, his parents, and his siblings were forced at gunpoint into the bush near a river. And then he watched as the rebels killed his father. He watched as they slashed away at his mother with their knives, And then, as she lay grievously wounded, a rebel commander turned and spoke to the children.
Then they said that we must kill our mother.
Horrified, Patrick and his young brothers and sisters refused.
Then they said, if you refuse, they're going to kill us all. Then we do that so. Then after that...
Well, wait a minute, Patrick. Then you had to kill your own mother?
Yeah. With fear to be killed, we kill our mother.
It's hard for you to remember that, isn't it? Do you dream about that?
Sometimes I dream.
Occasionally, as we talked, Patrick seemed to get lost in his thoughts, searching his memory for his mother, as he so often does, wondering what he'll do without her.
I'm thinking, without my mother, how can I stay in the world?
And year after year goes by with more of this every day. Children losing mothers and fathers losing children. Who is there to protect them? In the midst of all this misery, there are some voices of hope. Like this remarkable woman who would face a heart-wrenching Sophie's Choice in order to save the children. And this Lone Ranger, a gun-toting preacher who has his own ideas about how to handle Kony and his rebels.
If you see him, you better shoot him quick because they'll shoot you.
A self-styled warrior of God on a search-and-destroy mission to rout out Joseph Kony.
If you ran into him, what would you do?
We're going to fight. We're going to fight, and I'm going to win.
Meaning what? You'd kill him?
Saving the children.
Returning to our story, they're only children, but they've witnessed horrors that will haunt them the rest of their lives. What can be done to stop the man who has caused these children so much pain and loss? You're about to meet two very different people with very different answers. Can either one make a difference? Once again, Keith Morrison.
Hard for you to remember that, isn't it?
Patrick was 10 when the rebels took him. A tiny, frightened boy when they made him kill his own mother, his initiation, and his first victim. As one of rebel leader Joseph Kony's child soldiers, during his year in captivity, he witnessed countless atrocities.
Babies.
They killed babies?
If he started crying in the bush there, they can throw it and do it like this. That's how the world of Northern Uganda here is.
Now, he's escaped, but he's terrified of being recaptured and has joined the tens of thousands of so-called night commuters in northern Uganda, each one of them simply hoping to stay alive to see the morning. How are they to be protected against a man so maniacal as to claim to speak for God? This American preacher believes God has given him the answer.
I always like to fight. Still do. I'm a preacher, but I still like to fight.
Reverend Sam Childers is the son of a Pennsylvania iron worker, a former biker who rode with the Hell's Angels, born again, now supported by contributions from the American evangelical community. He goes on military-style rescue missions for abducted children, even joins with local African militias to hunt Kony down. Is it fair to say that you're a missionary, or are you a mercenary?
A lot of people call me a Christian mercenary. And I will accept it either way.
7 years ago, Childers built an orphanage on the border of Uganda and Sudan. As it turns out, the same region where children like Patrick are held captive. He offers us a ride along the treacherous trip to his orphanage. And we'll soon see just how hard it would be for any child to escape the rebels in these rugged badlands. We're joined by Childers' personal militia, 35 seasoned fighters from Sudan who joined hands to pray for protection.
Let us pray.
They also put their faith in a veritable weapons arsenal. Rifles, AK-47s, machine guns. This boy, who looks about 14, handles a rocket-propelled grenade launcher. The pastor drives with a pistol on his seat and, when he senses trouble, a rifle on his lap.
If you see them, you better shoot them quick, because they'll shoot you. Yeah, you don't even play around with them.
His little army rides the truck behind him down a hot, dusty road littered with remnants of battles past. Along the way, he stops to show us a school attacked by rebels, where he says students were given a gruesome choice.
They came here, they took the teachers, killed all the teachers, took one, chopped him up, started cooking him. The children that would eat him, they left the children go, and any of the other children, they'd shoot him in the head. The bodies were stacked high of children.
Difficult to believe, but human rights groups have documented similar cases.
This area here.
4 hours later.
Yeah, because the border is right down there.
He and his men arrive at the orphanage. If you've ever wondered where the middle of nowhere is, this is pretty close. Here, though the rebel soldiers are never far away, children like Betty and Mary find refuge from the horrors they experienced beyond the orphanage fence. Mary shows us a large scar from a severe lashing the rebels gave her.
They beat me, and then they even tied me.
Betty, only 11, holds this dark memory.
The man went to where the fighting was. They cut his head off, and he died.
But still, it's the loss of her parents that haunts her the most.
I have a dream that comes to me, that my mom and my father are alive.
And so they are scarred and traumatized, but here, somehow, at home. Their oasis amid chaos, where there is a semblance of routine and normalcy. Here it appears, at least, fear is held at bay, night terrors chased off by song. But rebel leader Kony's terror is never far from Childer's mind. What would you do with him if you could find him?
He needs to pay for the crimes that he's done.
But if you saw him, if you ran into him, what would you do?
We're going to fight. We're going to fight, and I'm going to win.
Meaning what? You'd kill him?
I'm going to win. I'm going to win, definitely. Yeah.
Well, it may make sense for some to use violence to fight Kony's violence. There is something very unusual about this little country in the middle of Africa. Many people here choose an entirely different approach.
The bullets have been flying for all these years. It is almost 20 years. Guns don't solve problems.
Her name is Angelina Acham. She says a peaceful strategy is the only answer. And that's all the more surprising because of what happened to her own daughter, Charlotte. Charlotte was one of more than 100 abducted at gunpoint by Kony's rebels from a girls' boarding school.
They were already gone very far away.
And Charlotte became a so-called wife to one of Kony's commanders.
They were given out, you know, like things, not like people.
And soon enough, Charlotte had 2 children in captivity. Here she is with her children at a rebel encampment, the photos smuggled out of the bush. Parents of the stolen schoolgirls decided to turn their pain into action, and Angelina, a humble midwife, soon began to speak for them, going from village to village, then across the world, making a name for herself as she met with the prominent and the powerful. She was even invited to speak at the United Nations.
If you act quickly, you can save life.
Joseph Kony, the leader of the Lord's Resistance Army, heard about Angelina's crusade and did not like the attention she was bringing his way. His rebels summoned Angelina to a secret meeting.
You received an offer from them. What was that?
It was giving me my daughter in exchange for silence, not to talk about them.
She could have her daughter back. All she needed to do was keep quiet, a kind of Sophie's choice. The rebels waited for her answer, and Angelina said no.
I told them that is unacceptable.
Unacceptable, no deal.
How can you do that as the mother of Charlotte?
If I had asked for Charlotte and she came back and... What about the rest? What about other parents? What about these very many children? And what about their mothers? The pain I feel is what also they feel.
And then years passed, until the day she got a phone call. Fateful news about Charlotte. The caller didn't mince words.
He told me, your daughter is here.
Charlotte had escaped.
Were those the words?
Yes, your daughter is here.
It was a joyous reunion.
And when she looked at me, she was carrying a child. She just put him down and she ran to meet me, and I ran to meet her. And we couldn't talk. We just cried for a long, long, long time.
Today, Charlotte is 22, making up for lost time back at a boarding school, this one in southern Uganda, far away from Kony's rebels. Her children live with their grandmother, Angelina. And Charlotte still holds out hope for all the other children.
I never lost that hope, because I know if there's still life, there's something that can still be done.
So, what can be done? Retribution? Her mother doesn't ask for that. To end it all, she turns to a tribal tradition of forgiveness.
Admitting guilt, asking to be forgiven, is all we need from them.
It's hard to fathom. But Angelina and many leaders here in northern Uganda say it's time to actually forgive Kony and his rebels. The only way is amnesty, immunity from prosecution, if they'll just stop fighting and stop abducting children.
Nobody can ever make a restitution for us. We are sacrificing justice for sustainable peace.
Is she right? Certainly, says the UN John Eglin, the rest of the world has yet to help win justice for the children of Uganda.
This is an outrage we cannot tolerate.
And yet, he says, the world does tolerate it.
I have a deep sense of frustration because I feel I'm failing, because we are all failing. That's something every
human being. So they wait, like Patrick, the former child soldier. We asked him, what do you want Americans to know? And he said,
we as the children of northern Uganda, we so tired with that war.
Let the blessing of the Lord come down.
But tonight and every night, tens of thousands of night commuters will stream into northern Ugandan towns, hoping to stay alive long enough to see the morning. And somewhere among them is little Patrick, forced to kill his own mother, still trying to learn how to live without her. And yet, they smile, they laugh, they sing. Just children, with nothing left but resilience and hope.
The UN's International Criminal Court is preparing indictments against Joseph Kony and his top commanders for crimes against humanity. And if you're wondering what the U.S. government is doing, the State Department says it contributes tens of millions of dollars for humanitarian aid to Ugandans forced from their homes. To learn more about the children of war and the crisis in Uganda, visit our website. The address is dateline.msnbc.com.